Distinguished delegates, please take a seat. I call to order the sixth meeting of the 55th session of the Commission for Social Development. I invite the Commission to begin its consideration of sub-item 3B entitled Review of Relevant United Nations Plans and Programs of Action pertaining to the situation of social groups. And I welcome you all to the high-level panel discussion on leaving no one behind, poverty and disability. As in the other panels, I'm not going to make any opening remarks because you're here to listen to our panelists, and I would therefore like to welcome them and quickly say who they are. We have with us this morning, it's a pleasure, again, Her Excellency Ms. Ana Elena Chacon, Vice President of Costa Rica. We have further to the right, Ms. Catalina de Vandas Aguilar, Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities of the Human Rights Council. We have on the left, Mr. Steen Lau Jørgensen, Director in Charge of Social Protection and Labor at the World Bank Group. And at the far left of me, Mr. Mosharraf Hossain, Director of Global Policy, Influencing and Research of ADD International. And we will have Mrs. Maria Aparecida Borghetti, Vice Governor of the State of Paraná of Brazil, who will be our lead discussant today from the floor. I also welcome our moderator, Ms. Nora Gross, Professor and Director of Leonard Cheshire Center for Disability and Inclusive Development of the University of College of London in the United Kingdom. Ms. Gross is well known internationally for her expertise in disability, international development cooperation, implementation and monitoring of internationally agreed development goals, including the MDGs. Her research interests include issues of disability in poverty, health and development, violence as a global public health problem, and equity in access to care and services in ethnic, minority, and rural communities. Ms. Gross regularly serves as an advisor to the World Health Organization, UNICEF, UNFPA, and a number of non-governmental organizations and disabled people's organizations. Prior to coming to the University College London, Ms. Gross was a research scientist at Harvard University, an associate professor in global health at Yale University, and director of the Yale World Health Organization Collaborating Center. So without further ado, I'm delighted to hand over the floor to our moderator, Ms. Gross, for this panel discussion. You have the floor, madam.
Good morning and welcome. Thank you all for coming. As moderator, I've been asked to open with a few brief statements, and I'll keep them brief because I'm anxious that we hear as much from our distinguished panelists as possible and then generate as much discussion from the floor. I've been asked to talk about disability and poverty, and I'm delighted that this session is going on today. I will argue three things very quickly. One is that there was never a time when inclusion of the world's 1 billion people with disabilities was more vitally important in international development aims and goals than it is now. The SDGs provides a new forum for inclusion that did not exist in the MDGs, and it is a unique opportunity that must be utilized to its full. Also, there was never a time when it would be more effective to include disability. Over the past 10 years, and particularly over the past 5 years, there is now a emerging evidence base on disabilities that did not exist previously that allows us to make much more informed decisions and interventions. We have a legal framework, the CRPD, the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, but also a legal architecture in many countries now that allows us to take what we know about disability and put it in usable formats. We have expertise that has emerged both globally and nationally and often locally on disability that simply did not exist until recently. Disabled people's organizations and NGOs have several decades now of experience working in international development. Governments increasingly have experts on disability, not just in one ministry, but in many ministries. There are certainly gaps, and there's areas that need improvement. But unlike even 5 years ago, you now have disability awareness and some activities in many governments around the world, and in many with many countries, you have an increasing amount of real expertise on hand that can and should be called upon. And finally, you have expertise in civil society. And lastly, you have much more efficiency now in terms of being able to generate information about disability and include it in international development efforts, and particularly poverty and anti-poverty efforts. Methodologies such as the Washington Group on Disability Statistics, which now has an easy, short set of questions that can be dropped into many censuses, surveys, research endeavors, will allow us often with as little as 1 or 2 minutes of inclusion of disability in broader efforts to gather information, ways to accrue and then analyze information on people with disability as part of broader poverty eradication efforts. So it's no longer true that we don't have the data, that we don't have the expertise, and we don't have the commitment. What we need now, and hopefully what this panel will provide us with, is new and innovative ways forward in ensuring systematic, routine inclusion of people with disabilities in all development efforts. So having said that, I will now turn the panel over to our speakers who will discuss many of these issues and hopefully a number of more in greater detail. Let me start by the introduction of our first speaker, Her Excellency Mrs. Ana Helena Chacon. Mrs. Chacon is Vice President of Costa Rica. Through the Social Council and the Innovation and Human Talent Council of the Presidency, she coordinates ministries and public institutions in their efforts to reduce poverty and achieve social development. Vice President Chacon has held positions in both public and private institutions where she consistently defends human rights. Over the past 20 years, she has worked on poverty, disability, infancy, and gender issues, and she is extremely well-known and respected in the field. So without further ado, let me turn the floor over to Mrs. Chacon.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very much. It is a great honor for me to be on this panel and share it with such important person who have focused on the cause of poverty and disability. And to speak about both of these is to speak about human rights. It is also to speak about exclusions, of deficiencies, of stigmas, and the huge responsibility that exists in states and the lack of compliance of these rights in many nations in the world. And even though the situation of poverty becomes flagrant violence for those who are the weakest, and if we add to this the status of disability, then exclusion, injustice, and lack of protection exponentially multiply. Therefore, one of the main challenges for our societies is to understand that people with disabilities are subjects with rights and not the objects of harm, handouts, or compassion. Their human rights are theirs. They are not residual concessions of a society which, because they don't wish to understand them, disregards them and discriminates against them. And this more specifically occurs for younger people who are subject to rights and not and who should not be discriminated, where inclusive education should exist in all states. We have to recall that human dignity don't have chosen persons. They do not favor one person over another. It's unique, enormous, marvelous. and it belongs to all persons merely because they are human beings. Dignity belongs to us. Existing makes us the owners of it, and that is what should exist in all social environments. Here we can see tolerance, respect for diversity, with other nuances, and it is the best way to be different and for the other. We cannot lose from sight that currently disability is understood as a dynamic circumstance from a scientific point of view, which depends on the conditions of the environment. And that's important because clearly it's not a question of people with disabilities adapt to our environment, but rather we have to guarantee effective compliance of their rights and adapt to them and their characteristics. According to the WHO, disability is defined by the barriers of the context of persons who are disabled. If they have difficulties in going upstairs, or like myself, or have whether they will have elevators where I can reach where I want to go. And that is not only a biological aspect, but rather interacting with the person in this context. That is what allows for barriers. And these can be physical, behavioral, and legal. And this occurs in many countries. And Costa Rica has worked because a law of autonomy for people with disabilities and not allow them just to die intellectually. And with this hostile environment, it is not strange that this population exists among the poorest, and they are the ones who suffer most from economic and social exclusion. I continue to quote the WHO, and for example, in Latin America and in the Caribbean, there are about 79 million people who have some type of disability, and more than 80% of these live and survive in poverty. As well as this, between 20% and 30% of girls and boys attend school because of problems in the infrastructure, lack of transport, teachers who are not properly trained, and other adversities which occur where people say, I can't teach people because I'm not a specialist. They have to be able to transmit information, and we have to make sure that they remain in school. As well as this, about 80 to 90% of people with disabilities don't have jobs in Latin America. And those who do have it have low wages or no monetary compensation. Therefore, Professor Amartya Sen says the poverty line for people with disabilities has to take into account the additional costs they incur when their income is translated into the possibility of living well. Many studies have concluded that the majority of people with disabilities live in poverty and exclusion, and they are therefore the most excluded among the excluded. And here, not only people with disabilities, but also the mothers of the families who are heads of household. In summary, disability has an effect on poverty because the environment so determines it, reduces possibility of inclusion for education and work, and prevents them from having well-paid jobs. Furthermore, poverty generates and exacerbates the effects of disability. There is a perverse cycle that disability causes poverty and poverty causes disability. Aware of that reality, Costa Rica has reaffirmed its commitment for respect to human rights by means of the National Plan for the Progress and Compliance of the SDGs in September 2016. As a country, we have begun a national discussion about the SDGs. And it is necessary to recall that people with disabilities have been mentioned specifically in 4 of the 17 goals, and this is significant progress for those who are fighting. Our goal is precisely to break the perverse cycle, which I spoke to you about, of poverty and disability. And to achieve this, the government of the Republic is encouraging public policies, which, in principle, we speak about accessibility to be included in all the regular development programs. There has to be an effective system to share information on the goals and the results of the projects which exist in this area. We wish to have a more comprehensive approach to the fight against poverty and include in this context the characteristics of people with disabilities. An innovative paradigm approach is necessary to highlight this population, including elements like, as was adopted by the Multidimensional Poverty Index, a social identification record which takes into account whether the family who are poor has anybody in the family who has disability among its members. The national strategy also has a bridge to development, and its content is to reduce extreme poverty and gives priority to people with disabilities for access to services, among other fundamental variables. These are decisions of a firm political will. We have to remove from the population from obscurity and aim for a society which is more inclusive and just. We must have a more just and egalitarian society where the differences are respected and where all these persons can live with dignity, with rights, and with respect of all their human rights, and finally ensure that no one is left behind. Thank you.
Thank you. You've raised a number of very important points. And we'll come back to it in the discussion. I'm going to go on to our next discussant now, and I'm delighted to introduce Mrs. Catalina Livandas Aguila. She is the Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities of the Human Rights Council. She is by training a lawyer and a human rights advocate who has worked extensively on disability issues at the national, regional, and international levels, and she has made major contributions to the field over the past many years, and we're delighted to have her here today. Let me turn the floor over to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Señor Presidente.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, panelists, delegates, I'm grateful for this opportunity to participate in this panel, which allows us to reflect about a subject of vital importance, how we can end poverty, which affects millions of persons with disabilities, how we can break this vicious cycle, which the Vice President has mentioned, which places disability persons among the most underrepresented among the poor. I'd like to recall that at a global level, at least 125 million persons with disabilities live in conditions of extreme poverty. The figure is quite conservative because it doesn't take into account the multidimensional character of poverty, nor different studies which demonstrate that persons with disabilities are disproportionately affected by poverty, both in developed and developing countries. The evidence is clear. There is a significant correlation between disability and inequality, which affects 50% of the global population. This inequality and the poverty not only has an impact on people with disabilities, but also affects directly their families and their close circles. 25% of households in the world have at least one member with disabilities. Furthermore, the impact of poverty is greater for women, as Mrs. Elena said. Both those who have disabilities, those, the wives, mothers, and girls who are obliged to stop working or studying because of the lack of public support to take care of the needs of their families with disabilities. This strong link between poverty and disability also has a negative impact on the process of development of our countries. When persons with disabilities are poor, they face greater barriers for their participation. They have less likelihood to study, work, or have decent jobs, and therefore contribute less to economic growth. It is estimated that the cost of this labor exclusion could be equivalent to between 1 to 7% of the GDP of a country, a percentage which does not take into account the impact on the families and lost opportunities. To combat poverty, which affects hundreds of millions of persons with disabilities, first we have to understand the causes. Persons with disabilities are not poor because of a physical, sensory, or mental condition prevents them from generating sufficient income. No, persons with disabilities are poor because our societies significantly limit our possibility to participate and actively contribute. The exclusion of persons with disability in the labor market contributes significantly to explain the high levels of poverty which affect them. The lack of access to education also has important repercussions at the adult stage of persons with disabilities and leads to subemployment or unemployment, discrimination and the stigma, as well as the existence of barriers in the environment. Transport and communications are structural causes of poverty and exclusion faced by persons with disabilities. Furthermore, we have to add that very often we share in the additional costs we have to bear living with a disability, either because of the need of buying articles and specific services for persons with disabilities, like personal assistance or support devices or technological assistance, or because persons with disabilities are obliged to pay more than the rest of the population for basic services, like transport, health, or education. Generally, persons with disabilities have greater expenses than other people. It is estimated that the additional cost of living with a disability is equivalent to 30% of an average wage in a country. When we take into account this cost, the standard of living of persons with disabilities, including those who are not under the poverty threshold, diminishes considerably. Despite all of this evidence, systems for social protection, programs for poverty reductions, and development programs do not include specifically persons with disabilities, nor do they respond adequately to their concrete needs. This is despite the fact that in the last decade, most of the developing countries have new poverty reduction programs which could have been beneficial to persons with disabilities and help them to be lifted from poverty. Unfortunately, among many politicians at international and national levels, there is still a fatalistic approach to disability, assuming that the only possible response to poverty is mitigation of its effect for persons with disabilities. The Massachusetts University study said that out of 2,577 current projects of the World Bank, and I'm glad that we have on our panel the director of Programs for Social Protection, because it would be interesting to speak with him about this. Out of the 2,576 current projects, only 2% include persons with disabilities. Strangely enough, there are economists in the World Bank which question the existence between the linkage between disability and poverty, which we're discussing here today. Achieving a world with equity and social justice requires societies where the basic needs of all of its members are covered. It is important that all of the actors working on eradicating poverty and promoting development adjust their actions to ensure a disability perspective in the implementation of Agenda 2030 for sustainable development. Clearly, there are many factors which require focus for building inclusive societies for persons with disabilities. As my mandate is aimed at proposing to states and the international community two important guidelines to make progress in building inclusive development. First, ensure inclusive policies for persons with disabilities, which will incorporate their demands and specific needs in their design and implementation. And secondly, ensure social protection systems which consider persons with disability, reduce their levels of poverty, and promote their independence and inclusion in society. Both strategies have been submitted to the General Assembly of the United Nations, and so I won't enter into detail. However, I would like to highlight certain common elements which are central to our discussion today. First point is that we need comprehensive responses which promote human development, social inclusion, and the participation in the community of all persons with disabilities. The remedial and compensatory programs for poverty are insufficient. It is necessary to attack the structural causes of poverty and inequality, which determines that a great percentage of persons with disability are poor or are in situations of social disadvantage. We need universal social protection systems, which include persons with disability. On the one hand, it includes disability in all of the programs, and also guarantees access to programs and services which are specific to deal with needs of the disability, persons with disability. We also have to ensure active participation of persons with disabilities in the formulation, implementation, and monitoring and evaluation of all politics and programs for development. The structural barriers which cause poverty and exclusion of persons with disability cannot be overcome without their direct participation. As rapporteur, I have cooperated with the Council for Human Rights on a thematic study which has common guidelines to ensure effective and active participation of persons with disabilities. A third point is that we need all of the United Nations agencies adjust and update their framework for actions for the inclusion and participation of persons with disabilities. The World Bank, UNDP, and other agencies have an active role to play in achieving Goal 1 of Agenda 2030. UNDP's program has already evaluated to know how we are considering persons with disabilities in their operations. UNICEF has taken important steps also. Other agencies should follow this example and develop indicators which allow us to measure how their efforts are benefiting people with disabilities. An additional point is that we need to include persons with disabilities in the processes for data collection on poverty. If we don't know how many people with disabilities are poor, we cannot measure how the efforts to fight against poverty are benefiting them. To give effective follow-up to the SDGs without leaving any behind persons with disabilities, it is imperative to have disaggregated data for disability. The sources of statistics should use the questions on the Washington Group on Statistics on Disabilities, as recommended by all of the United Nations agencies. It is a priority that household surveys, which currently are being reviewed, include these questions to guarantee information on the levels of poverty and exclusion of persons with disabilities. UNICEF has taken important steps in this direction with the elaboration of a special module for MIX. And we hope that other agencies, including the World Bank, will make progress in the same direction. Finally, even though it is clear all efforts to fight against poverty must promote and protect the rights and dignity of persons with disabilities. That means abandoning medical and charity approaches and adopted the approach of human rights, where people with disabilities are rights holders and not mere recipients of protection, rehabilitation, and charity. The conventions on the rights of persons with disabilities must guide the implementation of Agenda 2030. Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development is a unique opportunity to reduce inequality and put an end to poverty in all of its forms and everywhere. However, these goals cannot be achieved without persons with disabilities. Persons with disabilities have to be part of this process, and we have a great deal to offer. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm struck by how the speakers here today are putting in their comments real substantive both information and ideas that I hope you're picking up on. These are cutting-edge issues, and again, now could not be a more important time to consider them. Having said that, I have the pleasure of turning the floor over next to Mr. Steen Lau Jorgensen. He is the director in charge of social protection and labor in the World Bank Group. Mr. Jorgensen has worked on strategy and operational activities across a number of themes, including economic and social development, human development, governance, and community empowerment for 30 years in the World Bank. He has worked across the developing world and in transition countries and has a long and impressive list of accomplishments that speak to his ability and knowledge in the area of social protection and labor. So without further ado, I turn the floor over to Mr. Jorgensen.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, honorable panelists, Your Excellencies, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor to be here. I feel completely out of place in this panel of experts. We are a development agency at the World Bank, and we do our best to include things, but as the previous speaker said, this is very much a journey in progress. I think the progressive realization of rights is something we should all be concerned with. We are not a human rights-based organization, but we still have an obligation to help states meet their obligations under the rights conventions. As the previous speakers have said, and I don't want to repeat it, we know about 15% of the world population live with some disability. And also, as the previous speakers have said, I was rather surprised to learn that I don't think we have enough data here. These are old numbers that we are still using. So I do think, and I agree with Dr. Catalina, that we really need to be thinking about improving those statistics. I also think that, like the previous two speakers said, we have to say that there are two things. It's not enough that I can't see anymore because I'm getting old, but I can afford to go get a pair of glasses and use them and see it. Because my environment is such that I can deal with this very small beginning health impairment, right? But many people around the world, once they get the health impairment, do not live in an environment that allows them to deal and move forward in their life. And that's the difference. So those are the two areas we have to be working on. We know that across the world, people with disabilities and households that have people with disabilities in them experience worse socioeconomic conditions. We know that on average, as a group, people with disabilities have less education, lower levels of labor force participation, lower wages, and higher levels of poverty. We know that they have higher needs for services than people without disabilities, yet they experience higher levels of unmet demand. And as the previous speaker said, in all settings, disabled people and their families incur additional costs to achieve a standard of living equivalent to that of non-disabled people. So disability may increase the risk of poverty, and poverty may increase the risk of disability. But again, it's not just the physical action of being, you know, getting the health shock, but the environment has a crucial factor in facilitating or restricting functioning participation in the economy and society for people with disabilities. There are widespread barriers. Some of them have already been mentioned: inadequate policies and standards, negative attitudes, lack of provision of services, problems with the quality of those services if they are delivered, inadequate funding, lack of accessibility, lack of consultation and involvement, and, like I already mentioned, lack of data and evidence. So what can we do about this? And I think this is where I'm very glad that the Commission is taking this on, because we know what the right, where we want to be headed. That's been stated in the conventions. But we need to figure out a way how to get there and how to help our friends and partners in developing countries get there. So the first thing is obviously to prevent the health impairment from happening first. And here there is standard old-fashioned health prevention things, especially on non-communicable diseases. We know that many non-communicable diseases lead to potential impairment. There are issues like road safety, so that we can prevent some of the accidents. There's obviously climate change mitigation, so that we can prevent some of the weather-related disasters that are getting more and more things. And in general, there's disaster preparedness. There's peace building. My last posting was in the Middle East, and I had the chance to see many people who suffer from the conflicts. So again, and I've seen the both mental and physical impairments that result from that. And finally, it's about inclusive education and social protection policies to enhance the human capabilities so people have something to withstand the shock. So what to do? In addition to doing these preventive measures, I think it's essential that we improve the environment as well, so the negative impact of the health impairment can be reduced. And that means including vulnerable groups into our projects, a basic non-discrimination parameter. As the previous speaker said, this is very much a journey in progress. I mean, I don't quite agree with those numbers. Doesn't matter. It's not the majority of World Bank projects that today explicitly take on people with disability. That's absolutely true. So, but what we can do and where we're beginning to see some good results is around accessible transportation and the built environment. It's about disability-inclusive social protection and skills development projects. For example, we did a study on the Middle East and North Africa. It's very clear that formal sector workers are protected and insured, but those in the informal sector are not. So how do we make the universal, how do you make social policies truly universal? We've also had some good experience, for instance, in Jamaica with a skills project that directly target the abilities of people with disabilities. We need to include people with disabilities in community development projects. There are some interesting examples in India that are just being evaluated that looks like this not only enhances the life of those people, but also enhances the life of the community overall. We need to think about enhancing care. With the demographic transition in developing countries, where more and more are having an aging population, this is going to be increasingly important. And there's actually economic development that can be gained from this if it's managed well. And then I know, which is more controversial here, we would say that we need really good targeting of those that are most vulnerable. And it's absolutely true that when we target, we need to take into account the additional costs that people with disabilities face. Second point is really around how we do things. It's not enough what we do, but also how we do it. And there, I think, I'm very glad, I'm honored to be next to Mr. Musharraf here, because we really need to be working with people with disabilities and people and their organizations in how we design, implement, monitor, and track development projects. We know that participation in general leads to better projects, so why not also do the same thing for people with disability? And final point, and I won't belabor it, we need better data. We need better data in household surveys. There's still a long way to go. I'm glad that Her Excellency, the Vice President, feel we've gotten somewhere. Yes, we've gotten somewhere, but we need to go further. Finally, let me just turn inwards a little bit and talk a bit about partnerships and the World Bank. We're very proud of a partnership we've just launched with the International Labour Organization on Universal Social Protection. We're very proud of the work we do with UNICEF on data and monitoring and also on practical programs in many countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. So I think those are partnerships we're excited about, because it is when we start talking about universality that we can all agree. It doesn't matter where we come from, whether we come from a development, a poverty reduction, or a human rights background, we all agree that things have to be universal. Finally, we need to be talking about the data. We are supporting support to household surveys. We're partnering with WHO on model disability surveys, like the previous speaker said, the good work that UNICEF is doing. So those would be the way to go forward. But ladies and gentlemen, being in the World Bank, being an economist, I love numbers, right? Give me a number and I will give it to you, back to you, and I'll explain it five different ways. But we have to remember there are real people behind this. I think of Yusuf. He's a 13-year-old boy who lives in Gaza City. He's seen three wars in his community. I look in his eyes and I see fear. I see trouble. He was the lucky one. He did not get a physical impairment. He did not lose a parent, but he's scared. The one rehabilitation hospital is destroyed. It's now being rebuilt with funds. But these are the people we have to remember. How are we going to make sure that Yusuf becomes a productive citizen with rights and inclusion? That's the challenge to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let us turn now to our last speaker. Mr. Musharraf Hossein is currently the Director of Global Policy Influencing and Research at ADD International. He has been actively engaged in the negotiation of the SDGs and has spoken in different forums, including the UN Sustainable Development Summit in 2015, for the participation of persons with disabilities in the implementation of the SDGs. He has extensive experience in development, poverty, and disability. And I know he's traveled and widely and speaks often on these arenas, and so his experience is extensive. Musharraf.
Thank you, Noura. Mr. President of Commission for Social Development, distinguished panelists, the government representatives, colleagues of civil society organizations, and UN agencies. We are living in the world of 7 billion people. 1 billion of them are persons with disabilities. But only eight men have the same wealth as the 3.6 billion, half of the world populations who are in the bottom of the economic pyramid. This is the news we got last month from Oxfam International in the World Economic Forum in Davos. So we can imagine how unequal and unsustainable is the world we are living in today. But good news, to turn these situations, the global leaders pledge to leave no one behind. And they set goal one, end poverty in all its form, everywhere. And goal 10, to reduce inequality within and among countries. Persons with disabilities are amongst the most marginalized people. 80% of them live in poverty, many of them in extreme poverty. They are poor because they don't have access to land, finance, information, infrastructure. They face discriminations and identity-based exclusion. I'd like to thank the Commission for organizing this session on poverty and disability. Slide 2. I'll give you a presentation how market-based solution works for people with disabilities who live in extreme poverty. My presentation is based on the research done by ADD International, CODI International Institute, International Development Studies on market-based solution to extreme poverty. The research was supported by the Rockefeller Foundation. My presentation is more on opinion generated from the research than any recommendations. Slide 3, please. The first question of the research, can market include and benefit the most marginalized people with disabilities? The answer is, market can't solve inequality alone. However, if we are really committed to leave no one behind agenda, then they have a critical role in making sure that the most marginalized people are given opportunities. To do that, market-based solutions need to work harder to reach those who are farthest behind. Slide 4. The next question is, who are the most marginalized people? This picture is of a woman with disabilities of my own country, Bangladesh. This is an example of those who are living in extreme poverty. They face extreme poverty and social exclusion due to disability. They are part of 800 million people living in less than $1.9 per day. They are at the bottom of the economic empowerment pyramid. They have the only basic skill of primary education. They have only basic asset, less than 0.5 hectare land. They face prejudice and discrimination every day. They survive outside the economy through informal activities, mainly begging and relying on the families. Today, economic theories are all about economic growth, creating money and profit. They fail to reach to the people living in poverty. Rather, they have created 8 persons in the world who have the wealth of 3.6 people who are poor. Then how can we make this market-based solution inclusive? Most marginal people can enter into the market only if the system becomes inclusive. Market-based solutions will be inclusive of persons with disabilities through participation, capacity building, inclusive infrastructure, and sustainable solutions. Slide 6, please. Now I'll tell you what has worked in the market. Our research scanned for the promising example of market-based solutions throughout the world. We found that most effective approach not only supported individuals to access market, but also sought to make markets themselves more accessible. We found 5 entry points that provide ladders for marginalized people to climb the economic pyramid and reduce the barriers. The first, making the most of existing skills and assets the most marginalized people have. Second, organizing collectively amongst the most marginalized people, because we alone cannot make change. Third, coordinating the others in the market. The fourth, engaging employers to remove attitudinal and physical barriers in the workforce. And the fifth entry point is, which is called a leg up, pre-market social protection to pursue opportunities, a foot on the ladder before climbing the pyramid. Slide 6, 7, please. I can give you an example of Bangladesh, where ADD International influenced market actors, the garments industry of Bangladesh, for creating employment and making workforce in textile industries for all. I implement that project in Dhaka slum, providing a skill training on how to operate sewing machine to work in garments factories, creating awareness among the workers and garments owners, and influence the garments owners association to remove barriers so that people with disabilities can work in their companies. 200 persons with disabilities were graduated from extreme poverty. and ILO recognized this project as one of the best practices for creating employment of youth with disabilities in the world. Next slide, please. This is the video, but we cannot see it because the technical things. The next one, please. So now I'll tell you why market-based solutions need to reach to the most marginalized people. Market-based solutions alone cannot eradicate extreme poverty, but inclusive markets are crucial for global solution. It promotes human rights and dignity. Economic livelihood and financial independence are the key aspects of human rights. Political responsibility. Leave no one behind is the political commitment of all 193 countries. Inclusive market can assist the governments delivering for the poorest citizens. Security. The only way we can ensure security and prevent social unrest is through overcoming abject poverty and marginalization. Our political leadership give due attention to the security before it goes beyond control. Fourth, long-term economic benefit. World Bank economist is here behind me. So access to market have long-term tripartite benefits. It improves their livelihood. Markets have new customers base. And third, reduce public sector cost and income and increase tax revenue. Next slide, please. Our research found four enabling conditions fundamental to making market-based solutions more inclusive. First is social stigma is the root cause of social exclusion. We need social mobilization against social stigma and political mobilization to promote our rights. CRPD has ensured our rights, but it needs implementation. Second, we need strong social net so that disabled people are not falling down. We also need intermediary organization like NGOs and academia to build their capacity to participate in constructive dialogue and decision making. Third, social protection. It meets poor people's basic requirement, but social protection should enable them to climb the economic empowerment, not keeping them dependent years after years. Access to market needs accessible infrastructure. The World Bank economists told that is they are supporting accessible transport and infrastructure. I think that is crucial. I went to disabled people can go to school or look for a job only if the transport are accessible. Making markets inclusive or promoting inclusive economies are not easy tasks. To meet these conditions, we need partnership, collective investment of state, private sectors, and NGOs. A global for action hybrid partnership for change. In this world today, we alone cannot do and make big change, but we together, we can do a lot. So there is an African proverb. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. So our call of action is hybrid partnership with government, private sector, social movement, disabled people's organization, NGOs, and even UN agencies. Next slide, please. To ensure leave no one behind, different partnership has different role. The government must create enabling policies to empower people with disabilities to work in the market. The private sector integrate highly excluded group into the market process. Keeping them behind, we cannot make market sustainable. Social model, social movement, and DPOs connect those actors who are working in the market. Sometimes we, the disabled people, work among ourselves, but we need to develop our network with others. NGOs work with private sector together to create better outcome for those who are farthest behind. Today, next slide, please. Today, we are speaking in the Commission for Social Development. I have four recommendations for the Commission. The first, The Commission should convene a high-level meeting on market-based solution to extreme poverty and disability. Two, develop global action plan consistent to Sustainable Development Goal and CRPD. The current World Action Plan is very old, of last century. We need the current global action plan of this century that is consistent with SDG and CRPD. And the third, high-level panel, we review the progress, overall progress of the countries. But I recommend that is every UN mechanism and bodies should have their own mechanism to progress their commitment to SDG and disability. The fourth, this event is very effective. So I recommend to organize a session on disability and development in every commission, every year, keeping priority of the SDGs. Next slide, please. And if you want to join this conversation on market-based solution, please join us. And there is some resources through that we can get better understanding what it is. And thank you very much. If you have any question, I'll be very happy to reply.
Thank you very much for your thoughtful comments. What all the panelists have said, I won't reiterate here, but there is three common themes that I'd like to just point out. One is that consistently we find people with disabilities are not only poor, but disproportionately poorer than their non-disabled peers. I think it's fair to say that I've worked in many poor communities around the world, and when I go into those communities and ask to be taken to the doorstep of the poorest member of that community, almost invariably I will be taken to the doorstep of an individual who is disabled. Poverty, the second point is that poverty is not due to disability, but rather to the lack of people with disabilities having access to equal resources and the supports and mechanisms needed to ensure their full participation in society. We need to decouple the links between disability and poverty. They are not inevitably the same. It is the social determinants that cause them to be linked. And if that's the case, then they can also, with improved access to resources, equal access to resources, we can decouple them. And thirdly and importantly, there are solutions. There is a growing body of data. We have far to go. But we now have a much clearer idea of at least where to start with both problems and solutions. And this is a unique point of departure that would allow us to much more and increasingly effectively make sure that people with disabilities have equal access to all resources in society. As it was said, this is a journey, but is it a journey which we must take. I'm now pleased to ask for comment from the floor, starting with comments from Mrs. Maria Aparecida Borghetti, who is Vice Governor of the Parana State, I hope I pronounced that right, in Brazil. Mrs. Borghetti is a businesswoman. She holds a major in public management with a diploma in public policy. She is former head of the Parana State Representative and former congresswoman in the Brazilian Parliament. She's well known for her support on preventive health and rights for women and children and has worked tirelessly on behalf of vulnerable populations. Mrs. Borghetti? I understand she'll speak from the floor.
Senhor Presidente,
Mr. Chairman, Madam Moderator, I'm delighted to address you as the Vice Governor of Parana, a state of multicultural colonization located in the southern region of Brazil. Its capital, Curitiba, is a city that symbolizes the multi-ethnic aspect of the country. In addition to diversity, Curitiba is also an example of commitment to the guidelines of the new urban agenda. A particular note is the commitment to promote and an equal basis, mobility and access for people with disabilities to the physical environment as well as the services and opportunities of the city. Our efforts go beyond Curitiba. If you'll allow me, I would like to give a brief account of innovative measures in the pursuit of poverty eradication in my state. In Paraná, we developed the program Familia Paranese as a complementary action to the Bolsa Familia. Familia Paranese is a program aimed at eradicating poverty in which each family has its own individual monitoring plan. This includes personal credit, professional training, and measures customized for the needs of each household and the characteristics of each region. The program has an entrance and an exit door, providing complementary assistance for a period of 2 years. The aim is to support these families so that they can achieve their own autonomy. Since 2012, Familia Paranese has served more than 250,000 families with integrated actions in the areas of social assistance, agriculture, education, citizenship, human rights, health, safety, sanitation, and housing. During this period, the state of Paraná has reduced the state's extreme poverty rate by 57%, one of the best results in the country. Another complementary measure to Bolsa Familia at the national level is the Happy Child Program, an initiative of the government of President Michel Temer. This program's main strategy is to support families through weekly or bi-weekly home visits by professionals trained to identify opportunities and risks for child development in order to strengthen the family's capacities for childcare, protection, and education. This includes basic measures and assistance before and during pregnancy, during labor, and after birth, as well as the monitoring of the child's development. The Happy Child Program prioritizes pregnant women and children in families which are beneficiaries of income transfer programs, children with disabilities receiving social benefits, and children who are separated from family life by means of a protective measure. From my experience in the field, I can say that adequate preventive care in the child's first hours, days, and years is decisive for the child's healthy development. Studies point out that basic social policies and raising the awareness of society are fundamental to the promotion of the rights of people with disabilities. In Brazil, we are facing the challenge of the Zika virus syndrome. The Happy Child Program is also developing specific actions in this respect with the help of the Ministry of Health, UNICEF, and the Rede Sara Hospitals Network. By 2018, the federal government intends to serve about 4 million children. A government that invests in early childhood builds a better, more prepared, and socially fairer country. Together, we can exchange experiences and develop good practices with the aim of eradicating poverty and promoting the rights of people with disabilities while respecting the specific characteristics of each country. I invite all of you to learn more about the Happy Child and Paraná Family programs. I am available to discuss these issues in depth as well as answer any questions. Before concluding, I would like to thank the Secretariat for its support in the person of Daniela Bass, as well as the support of the Permanent Representative of Brazil to the UN Ambassador Mauro Vieira and his staff at this session. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your comments. Very interesting. I'm now going to open a discussion up to the floor. I request that delegates press the buttons in front of them if they want to speak, and we'll take them in the comments in order of the buttons pressed. Our first comment comes from the distinguished representative from Morocco.
Je vous remercie, Madame la.
Thank you, Chair. At the outset, my delegation welcomes the organization of this high-level debate, and we thank the panelists for their rich presentations. It has now been more than 10 years since the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities was adopted. And despite increasing international attention towards the issue of disabilities, numerous countries, in particular developing countries, continue to encounter substantial issues in combating poverty in general and inequality when it comes to persons with disabilities in particular. In addition to this, there are also numerous situations of armed conflict, natural disasters, and other security situations and humanitarian situations which displace thousands of persons each day as they flee to survive. These displaced populations include persons with disabilities. Among them are women and children who are doubly affected. They are very vulnerable and encounter not only the same difficulties as all those who are displaced, they also need to face the numerous additional challenges of multidimensional discriminations. Others are stuck in refugee camps, left to their own destiny without assistance. Madam Chair, persons with disabilities are at an increased risk of living in poverty. There are numerous contexts and situations that lead to them having decreased chances of obtaining proper health care when necessary. The scope of poverty and inequality from which they suffer is the result of a structural gap and lack of accessibility, as well as institutional obstacles, discrimination, exclusion, and lack of equal opportunity. My delegation was one of those that when the 2030 agenda was being negotiated, pushed actively for the inclusion of several references and provisions in the text that would reference the rights of persons with disabilities. Nonetheless, Madam Chair, without the necessary financing for ensuring accessibility and social services, reducing poverty and promoting equality will remain mere words on paper. Addressing the issues of persons with disabilities requires a multidimensional approach, as well as finances, and $111 million in national currency was dedicated to assisting persons with disabilities. The finance law of 2017 also allocates 50 billion dirham for the implementation of a program to reduce inequality. To conclude, Mr. Chair, I should like to say that my country, Morocco, holds each day on March 30th a day of persons with disabilities, which is an occasion to assess the situation of persons with disabilities in Morocco and reflect on the means necessary to meet the challenges related to this. I thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Our next comment will come from the distinguished representative from the European Union.
Okay.
Go ahead, please.
Thank you. Thank you, moderator, distinguished chair, and the members of the panel. Thanks for this thrilling discussion over this hugely important issue. As I said, it's hugely important for us. As you may know, the EU as a bloc has ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, and that was the first time in our history to join a international human rights treaty, and in doing so, we became bound to protect and ensure the full and equal enjoyment of all human rights and fundamental freedoms by all persons with disabilities. Besides, of course, we'd like to go beyond this and be even more practical. And for this, we are now currently working on a new initiative, which has been mentioned during the debates yesterday. So I will not go into detail, just to highlight that This focuses on key issues relevant for the elimination of poverty and inequalities also for persons with disabilities. For example, this new pillar would propose inclusive and flexible social protection systems designed to offer active support for employment and address disincentives to taking employment. Of course, we understand that benefits will continue to play a core role in supporting those unable to work, for instance, due to their age or disability-related barriers. But at the same time, we also strongly believe that it's very important to recognize that the access to the to and effective inclusion of persons with disabilities in productive employment has value beyond the pure cost-benefit logic of reducing disability benefits. Full economic inclusion, therefore, we believe is the single most important tool to empower persons with disabilities to lift themselves out of poverty, and it should also contribute to the realization of the right to work. In this respect, we very much appreciate the panel's focusing also on the rights aspect. But at the same time, of course, it is fundamental to combat stigma and discrimination associated with the misinterpretation of disability and productivity. Well, in the EU, persons with disabilities still face a higher risk of poverty and social exclusion than the other groups in society. Women in particular, they face up with much more significant barriers in terms of discrimination. And hence, we believe that intersectionality approach is the most appropriate tool to inform policies and legislation, which will ensure participation and the realization of the full potential of women with disabilities. We again very much appreciated thoughts gravitating to this point during the panel discussion. The persistent disability employment gap, or the gap between the persons with disabilities and persons without disabilities, in particular of working age, show also the need to step up related policies aiming at providing persons with disabilities enabling services and basic income security that allow a decent standard of living and enable them to be fully included in society. As I just mentioned, this pillar, a new initiative, European Pillar of Social Rights, is on the way, and the executive body of the EU will soon make a proposal to the governments in the EU. And what is very important, that the views of EU citizens with disabilities are taken into account at every stage of this consultation, and the proposal will complement other EU initiatives to reduce long-term unemployment and tackle youth unemployment, which has special relevance to persons with disabilities. In this way, our approach strongly resonates with those who are advocating for a much more a comprehensive approach. So we do hope that that the EU, together with its member states, will be able to update you about the progress at next year's session of this commission. And finally, if you allow me, I would like to put a question to the rapporteur, if she could perhaps single out the three most important points she would believe would be very important for her to be able to deliver on her mandate, and to what extent she considers her involvement in the work of this commission useful, and to what extent perhaps going forward in the future she would also be able to remain on board. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And also thank you for posing a question. We would strongly encourage not only statements but questions here. Should we ask the rapporteur to respond to the question now, or would you like a little time to think about it? Let us collect a few questions, and then if you could give it a bit of thought, then we will come back and get some responses from the panel. I should note we have a very distinguished panel here today, so if there was ever a question you had, this is the time to pose it. Let me turn next to the next person up on the list, which is a representative from the international NGO Inclusion International.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Mark Mapemba. I'm from Malawi, Central Africa, and I'm here to represent the International Disability Alliance, a network of 14 organizations of persons with disabilities. I'm also a member of Logo DPO in Malawi and a member of Inclusion Africa and Inclusion International. I'm here to speak to you as an intellectual disability self-advocate. I believe that self-advocates is important because we communicate with our communities and indeed the world. We communicate our needs and wants without involving third parties. We believe this brings more impact to our listeners as they get the information firsthand. Self-advocate alone works, but if it is combined with DPOs, it brings more impact. DPOs are doing excellent work. Without them, people with disabilities would not be able to represent themselves. This leads me to the most important subject, the inclusion of persons with disabilities in society. It is now proven that the inclusion of persons with disabilities in society provides equal opportunities and brings about acceptance and confidence to persons with disabilities. Disability is not inability. This also means passing laws fully including us and that do not marginalize us because of our disabilities. We need education for all. Our inclusion in society is the first step to addressing poverty. Including DPOs in all stages of planning, developing and carrying out policies and programs is the only way to assure inclusion. So I would like to ask a question. Well, why do we not have DPO on panelists today for this important discussion? And how do we work together in future to make sure DPOs are included in all discussions and decision-making processes that impact lives? This is the heart of CRPD Article 4.3. We want to see it at the table. Nothing about us without us. God bless. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments and your questions, and we will return to discuss the questions after we hear a few more statements from the floor. Could I next turn to a statement from, or hopefully statements and questions. So could we next turn to the distinguished representative from New Zealand?
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. And in fact, I'm not even going to deliver a statement, so it will just be questions and comments and a bit of thanking to you and your esteemed panelists for the extremely useful presentations. I think they're incredibly important in the context of negotiations we have underway at the Commission on Social Development on a text on persons with disabilities. And as we head into the Commission on the Status of Women, where our priority theme this year is women's economic empowerment in the changing world of work. So what you've said here today is incredibly important for the negotiations we're about to embark on for the agreed conclusions there. I want to also acknowledge the very helpful best practice sharing by Morocco, Brazil and EU. And thank you so much to Mark from IDA. The practical questions he posed and his call at the end is absolutely right. A seat at the table is needed. So firstly, a comment. I just wanted to really highlight and thank the panellists for raising the point on data. I think they're absolutely right that the household surveys really do need to be disability inclusive, and in that respect should include the Washington Group questions. My question, I think, is probably mostly for the Special Rapporteur, but I'd invite the other panellists to also respond. Special Rapporteur, you mentioned a number of measures and practical steps that needed to be taken by Member States. So my question to you is, what is the role of the UN, or what role can it play in supporting Member States to do what you're proposing? Thank you.
Thank you. I'd next like to call upon the distinguished representative from China.
I would like to thank Chair for giving me the opportunity to speak here. I thank the panelists for their excellent presentation. We highly appreciate that the Commission on Social Development to have a panel discussion on disability. We believe maintaining the relevant mechanism on disability is very important and necessary. This is going to provide us with a forum for sharing experiences, ideas, and conducting cooperation so that we can jointly be committed to the implementation of 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda, including the ones for disabilities. And China has 85 million people with disability. The Chinese government has been consistently attaching importance to the cause of the people with disabilities. Last year was the 10th anniversary of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability. At the commemoration, the State Council Committee on the Persons with Disability reiterated that China is an active proponent and steadfast implementer of the convention. As mentioned by many, it's vital to understand the conditions and the real needs of the persons with disabilities in order to help with their poverty alleviation, rehabilitation, and employment. In 2015, we conducted a special nationwide survey on the basic services for persons with disabilities and their needs, asking for their names and acquired dynamic information on 29.95 million persons with disabilities certification involving 700,000 villages and communities and their basic services they enjoy. This serves as an important basis for addressing poverty alleviation for this group of people, and these dynamic updates of the data will be a significant reference to determining if the conditions to improve the livelihood of the people have been achieved. In line with the needs of the group, we have instituted a system of livelihood subsidy for this group with financial difficulties and care subsidy for people with severe disabilities. As of August 2016, the 15 million people and times benefited from these subsidies, and the promulgation on the regulations on disability prevention and rehabilitation has integrated prevention of disability in health, environmental protection, and occupational safety in relevant sectors and services. Our national poverty alleviation efforts focus on this group. And in 2015, the State Council drafted the opinions on accelerating the process of the persons with disability to be well-to-do. Recently, the action plan on poverty alleviation for the group was adopted by the State Council leading group. And the poverty alleviation for persons with disabilities has developed into a diversified employment model for the group characterized by the proportional employment, concentrated employment, and self-employment supplemented by jobs in charitable organizations, in communities and financing and assisted employment whose share is growing. At the same time, we scaled up efforts in vocational training and practical skills training, plan on enhancing vocational skills for persons with disabilities has been drafted to promote employment and entrepreneurship of the group. As of December 2015, 559,000 people with disability received vocational training. We will continue to work steadfast in this direction. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is going to be the distinguished representative from Portugal, and I should note the representative is the Secretary of State for the Inclusion of Persons with Disabilities of Portugal.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, ladies and gentlemen. For me, it's an honor to speak to you again today on behalf of the Portuguese government, which is strictly committed with the human rights perspective and the promotion of the promotion of rights of persons with disability. Mr. President, today we are, this year we are celebrating the 11th anniversary of the Convention of Persons, Conventions of Rights of Persons with Disability, and fortunately we are fast moving to universal ratification of this convention. Portugal is also a member of this convention. We have ratified the convention in 2008. We have ratified the convention and its additional protocol. Not until recently in Portugal, persons with disability had not access to jobs at executives or, for example, in national parliaments. But fortunately, this reality has changed recently. Since 2015, we have the first deputy elected for our national parliament who is a person with disability. And we also have a state secretary, myself, to coordinate the areas, not only the areas of disability, but only the issues of childhood. Mr. President, the issue of resources is critical in this area, in my opinion. And of course, I have to say that the adjustment process that Portugal crosses in the last years had big consequences in the quality of life and dignity of persons with disability. Because in spite of all, persons with disability are still a vulnerable group. Considering the gap in labor market participation, the gap between people with or without disability, we can see how people with disability is still a vulnerable group. For example, in Portugal, our social security cash benefit system has stayed unchanged for many years. For example, during the last 20 years, our social security framework law were only reviewed for 3 times. Unfortunately, the consequence was the way that the system stayed too close and too protective to the persons with disability. of course, we are now trying to change this reality, but for years, the reality was that only have social security protection the persons that not have autonomy, and the persons who for some reasons didn't have success in entering or remaining in labor market. In last 2 years, we are really focused and motivated to change this reality with new policies and practices. I would like to highlight some politics that we are implementing in this moment 2016, 2017, that in our opinion can make a real difference in the daily life of persons with disability. The first example is the income individual benefit. We had recently created this social income who is classified and composed by three different components. These three different components are a based compound, who is a citizenship, who is inspired in a citizenship principle. And we consider with this based compound that every person with disability with a duly certified disability or incapacity of more equal or more than 80%, every person has access to this income. And every person who has a duly certified disability or incapacity between 60% and 79% has also access to this social income, but considering their own incomes, their professional or their professional incomes. The second component is a complementary component who has the objective to mitigate the impact of poverty, the risk of poverty to persons with disability. We don't want to have any person with disability under the poverty line in Portugal, and we think it's possible to achieve this objective in with this income benefit. The third component of this social income is a supplementary compound that is paid to support specific costs resulting of health, rehabilitation or education. The second measure that we are implementing this year in Portugal is our new program for independent living system. And we construct this program considering that every person with disability, independently of what kind of disability we are talking about, has the right to have some support of a personal assistant to help to realize some activities that he has difficult to do related to this their specific disability. So with these two main actions, they are the main, not the only, but I don't want to take more time, we are trying to transform our view about the disability. We are trying to transform politics in practices and trying to bring more dignity to the living conditions of persons with disability. I wouldn't like to finish without leaving a question to our relator about the perspective that she has about the how can what are your plans to put the disability issues, the disability questions in a perspective of mainstream in other areas, in other commissions of the European of the ONU. It's important to know because I think that one of our biggest difficulties is the way how we look to disability as a closed group. We need to promote the mainstreaming, in the disability, to look to the disability inside of the many different groups that discuss many other questions. Only this way we can fight for inclusion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let me here acknowledge the, that we have questions that from the floor from Mexico, Senegal, Japan, Zambia, School Sisters of Notre Dame, Botswana, and the Somali Help Age Association. And we will get to those shortly, but in just to change things or mix things up a bit, there's been a number of questions raised that probably our panelists would like to respond to. So let me just stop here for a minute before going on and taking more comments and questions from the floor and get back to several of the key questions that were raised in the past half hour or so. Let me start from the most specific to the more general ones. And probably the most specific is we had a question from the floor about the composition of this particular panel and how representation was chosen from the disability community.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I'm not going to enter into the substantive discussion of this panel. As you know, we had three panels in the commission, and the selection process is actually quite a long one and quite a difficult one, aiming at regional balance, gender balance, occupational balance. It's regional groups who can suggest. One member of the panel is always suggested by the NGO committee. That happens for every panel, and that happens so for this panel. We have a representative, Mr. Mosharraf, chosen by the NGO committee. We hear the point of inclusion. We believe that also we have the rapporteur, of course, and we have a lot of knowledge here, but we hear your point. There have been lots of discussions going on, also lots of ideas floating, what can be done maybe for next year. And I'm sure we can continue this after the panel and in the next couple of days to ensure that this commission is, as I said in my opening statements, as inclusive and all-encompassing as it should be. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question that kind of follows in a bit of logical order is there were three quick key questions for the special rapporteur. If she had to highlight three or prioritize three things that she thinks we should focus on, what would they be? So let me turn the floor over to the special rapporteur.
Thank you very much, Nora.
With regard to the priorities for the mandate, I think that the question includes what the role of the mandate in the Commission for Social Development. I think it is important to establish two things. First, the mandate must have a strong component in helping states to develop policies which are more inclusive for persons with disabilities and develop and support disability persons, including processes for the implementation of the SDGs. My priorities, as established at the beginning of my mandate, the first is to contribute in the fight to reduce poverty, which affects persons with disabilities. And in this mandate, one of my main functions is to avoid duplication and connect the needs to resources available and inform the United Nations and Member States about the principal challenges we persons with disabilities have so far as inclusive development is concerned. I think it is fundamental that the mandate of an independent expert for human rights should have links with this commission and inform the commission about the main challenges we face, but also oblige the rapporteur to have a linkage to this theme, because this is fundamental to improve the conditions of persons with disability. Whether you're a rapporteur or not, you have to be involved with reducing poverty and encouraging development and make sure it is participatory for people with disabilities. And in this respect, I hope that the relationship and cooperation will exist, and we could talk about the opportunities which can be generated when we share this information and avoid duplication of resources. And it is important that the rapporteur can function as an excellent catalyst for all of this experience which we're sharing here. Thank you.
Thank you. There were two questions, one posed by the distinguished representative from New Zealand and the other by the distinguished representative from Portugal, which sort of fit together. So I'm going to collapse them together and ask first panelists to discuss this and also ask people here from the UN system to both give it thought and allow us to discuss it further in the next hour or so that we have for this commission. The questions are, what role can the United Nations play in all of the issues we're talking about here? And how link question is, how are you going to mainstream disability into other existing commissions and other panels and projects that are underway? So this is not, as was pointed out, this should not be a closed group. People who work on disability and for many years have worked on disability recognize the fact that we often talk to each other but not more broadly, and that's not that we don't want to talk more broadly to the development community and the UN community, but often what we need, or always what we need, is buy-in, commitment, and participation by groups, organizations, advocates from many other of the standing commissions and the other committees that are found throughout the UN system. So where do we start, and where do you see the UN taking next steps next month, in the next 6 months, within the next few years, to ensure greater inclusion? Let me throw that first over to the panel members. Musharraf, why don't you start?
Okay, thank you, Noura. I think we need real inclusion, not tokenism. And United Nations has big role to ensure that. We disabled people should not speak only in disability session. We can speak in other session as well. My fellow disabled persons from DPO members, he mentioned that. And disabled people, we recognize that is there's a direct link between poverty and disability. And disabled people are poor. They don't have that capacity to come to this platform from many different countries and region. So United Nations should ensure that the grassroots disabled people who has lived experience, very strong experience, they can come in this platform and raise their voice and share their experience. And for that, there is so many different type of barriers is there, financial barriers is there, visa barriers is there. I think how United Nations can play a good role, that has to be think in that then, so that disabled people can ensure. I am very much impressed by how China has made progress in their countries. Very good. Thank you. But how we can increase our South-South cooperation? How the South Asian disabled peoples or the country or the South Asian countries can share your experience, and how we can give both technical, even many countries don't have financial support, so that the region as a whole, we can be disability inclusive and disabled people can be free from poverty and discriminations. So these are two are my recommendations.
Thank you. Can I invite other panel members to? Would you? Okay. Yeah, Catalina.
Thank you very much. I think that the various points we have to make. One is how each of the member countries have made the conventions and laws part of their constitutions, and there must be implementation of the convention, which is the final instrument and the best protector of persons with disabilities, and how we can adapt it to the local and national level. That's very important. Another point I wanted to refer to is the fact that people with disabilities must not only deal with themes of disabilities. Disability must be cross-cutting in all decisions of public policy, and we have to see how there can be affirmative actions so that persons with disabilities can have access to formal jobs, they can have access to comprehensive education. And here, I'd like to speak about the question which was asked about the comprehensiveness and integration of persons with disabilities at all public and private fora. I think what we have to speak about is education, and not see education as special education, but rather see it as comprehensive education. And from that point of view, we have to share in schools children who have differences, and otherwise, if we don't have comprehensive education, we will not be able to have formal jobs and openness, where we previously could not imagine persons with disabilities included because of the historical background they have had. Another point I'd like to make is that we have to seek decent jobs for persons with disabilities based on their ability and not their limitations. And if we change that approach, then we can make them competitive in a market which is generally excludes persons with disabilities. Then we'll have a shift in paradigm, and then we can have equal conditions with decent wages for persons with disabilities. Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much. As per the role of the UN in providing responses, what is the role of the UN in advancing the situation of persons with disabilities, I think it's fundamental. We really need to look at the enormous potential that the UN system has to advance the rights of persons with disabilities around the world. And I think that for that, it is important to look at how the UN system is building its own capacity to understand the challenges ahead in the implementation of the convention. We need to talk about how are we supporting resource allocation within the system, and what is the accountability mechanisms that we have in place to make sure that we are indeed advancing in the implementation of the convention and in the commitment of leaving no one behind. I've been advocating since I started my mandate, and more I convinced when I see the challenges we are facing as a system that we need to have a system-wide action plan on disability, because we need to have a coherent response to the challenges that we are discussing here, and that links to what was asked by the delegation of Portugal as well as the delegation of New Zealand in terms of how do we advance in this mainstreaming process and this considering persons with disabilities outside the specific, and how we need indeed that all UN agencies are working on the same line, trying to be as inclusive as possible of persons with disabilities. I think that one of the issues that for me are very important about this discussion is the whole issue of social protection, how we are advancing towards universal social protection that of course must be accessible and inclusive for persons with disabilities. And I would also like to congratulate countries like China, Portugal, Morocco, and the initiative mentioned by the EU with regards to how to make their systems more inclusive for persons with disabilities. And I will welcome to have further information on these initiatives that you are developing. But also I think that we have to make sure that the system is working in a coherent manner, so that, for instance, the Universal Social Protection Initiative that was mentioned by the representative of the World Bank, it's also considering the situation of persons with disabilities and providing guidance to states that are currently facing challenges in developing, designing, and implementing social protection systems that are inclusive of persons with disabilities. How do we get a more coordinated response that indeed is responding to the real challenges we have? I think that we really need to, I think one thing I want to note in, is to congratulate the Commission for organizing this panel indeed, because this has brought together a lot of information that can be you know, brought back to the different agencies, to the different parts of the systems, and they can take their own role. I think that one of the big missing parts of this puzzle after the 10th anniversary of the convention is actually what is the accountability mechanism that there is for the UN system to provide a response to the demands of countries. Because one of my roles as special rapporteur is provide assistance to states, but of course it's only one person that is here in front of you that doesn't have the capacity to do that, but the whole UN system has the mandate to provide that support. How do we make sure that that support is provided, that that assistance is provided, is what we have to do, and I think that working on a system-wide action plan will help us to do that.
Thank you. Let me turn the floor over now to Mr. Jorgensen from the bank.
Thank you very much. It would obviously be inappropriate for me to give recommendations to the UN system being in one of the specialized agencies. So suffice to say is that what we're looking for out there when we work with countries is really your guidance and your plan. I mean, so tell us that this is something that we should all be working on. Your leadership here is essential. You represent the membership, you represent the people, the governments that are here to tell us what to do. We are your agencies, right? We don't belong to anybody else but you. So that's why it's essential that you do it. On mainstreaming, I think we're very proud of the work we're doing with the ILO now on universal social protection. We need to keep reminding the people we work with out in the developing countries that this has to be completely inclusive. I think mainstreaming is the right way to go, but there is a very important point that you do not get mainstreaming just by saying it. You need special efforts. You need special reach out. That's why we need to know the data on who are the people with disabilities. It's why we need special accommodation so that we remember to hear the voices of people with disabilities when we each do our country strategies, the UNDAF process, whatever process each of the agencies follow. So mainstreaming will only come with special emphasis. It sounds contradictory, but it is essential that the voices are heard, that the special needs, the special circumstances, the higher cost of living in a family with a disabled person are recognized. So that I think is the challenge of mainstreaming. How do we mainstream while still making very clear that this is a special circumstance, a circumstance that we can deal with? Because we have to get back to the fundamental thing. Just because you have a physical impairment or a mental impairment does not make you disabled. It's the environment around you that makes it disabled. And that's what all of us can work with, whether we are in development agencies or in governments or in civil society. Thank you.
Thank you all for your comments. Let me just add one more thought, to reemphasize. This is a cross-cutting issue. If you work in water and sanitation, if you work in microcredit, you work on HIV/AIDS or gender or urban planning, if you have not previously thought about and dealt with disability, the question is, if not, why not? So the issue is to go back to many of the standard development issues and re-examine them with this new lens. If people with disabilities are not present in the work you do, then the question is, where are they? And what are you going to do to make sure their inclusion in future? Let us go back at this point to the list of comments from the floor. I should add one more. The minister from Ghana has asked to speak, and I believe, given the time constraints, we're going to close the list at this point. But let me first turn to the distinguished representative from Mexico and give the floor to the representative.
You all set? Yes. Okay.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. And Mr. Chairman, thank you for the presentations from all of the panelists at this important session meeting. A couple of months after this holding by the General Assembly of the 10th anniversary of the Convention on the Rights of Peoples with Disabilities. This is a document which really represents a new paradigm shift in the way in which we see persons with disabilities, and which has the clear nature of being an instrument for human rights, but also a tool for development. This is what we have, all member states of the United Nations have reiterated over the last 10 years, and we will continue to do so. Recognizing the services of accessibility and card interpretation, which I don't know if are present now, but this should be normal practice carried out at all official meetings of the United Nations system. We have also noted, panelists, that as of the discussions we have held, there's a new paradigm in the agenda, in the 2030 agenda. In all references to persons with disabilities, we see the momentum of the convention, and this is being reflected in the 2030 agenda. It is now time to see how we can take into account statistics and data. In this respect, we'd like to ask the Special Rapporteur about the best way in which we can support member states in data collection, with data collection, so that we have the necessary information so that we can attain all of the agenda goals. Otherwise, effectiveness would be very limited. A reference was made to the Washington Group, for instance. I think it would be interesting to examine this in depth, particularly as it is a subject which has been referred to by all of the membership in a General Assembly resolution. With regard to data, also, we'd like to consult the World Bank representative if he could talk a little more about this and the linkage between the social protection flaws and how we can link this to persons with disabilities. We also note the fact that throughout the agenda, we have to deal with each of the vulnerable groups present. And finally, I'd like to highlight the fact that it is a great pleasure to have the presence here of the Special Rapporteur at this Commission for Social Development. We think this is one of the best practices of the Commission. She has clearly said how her mandate has this component, and we think that this should be enshrined in the future work of the Commission, namely to have this daily dialogue with you. Thank you very much, Madam Moderator.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Because of competing commitments, we've been asked to go a bit out of order, and I'm going to ask the minister from Ghana next to speak.
Madam Moderator, it's a privilege to be here and to listen to the various passionate discussions about persons living with disability. In Ghana, most of our people living with disability have no employment. Their major economic means of earning a living is through begging. And so it's important that we find holistic measures to support them. So mine really is a question, how member states and the UN can put in place a holistic approach that would provide access to equipment in terms of wheelchairs, crutches, white canes, guard dogs, and how to use Braille and sign language. If somebody is begging, how can they afford to buy a wheelchair? Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Let me next take the distinguished representative from Senegal.
Merci.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator, for the opportunity to speak before this August Assembly. I'm the Director for the Promotion and Protection of Persons with Disabilities and member of the Delegation of Senegal. I thank the Chair and the Moderator for the quality of the moderation of this panel, as well as the panelists for their quality contributions. And I thank the organizers for convening a meeting on such a relevant topic that draws the link between handicap and poverty. Senegal has adopted a national law on disability in 2010 and developed a national report in 2014. And I should like to speak on the necessity to improve statistics on disability if we want to effectively combat poverty among persons with disability. And the panelists have shown the importance of ensuring quality statistics on disability. The Washington Group method was recommended, but I should like to recall that there are several approaches, such as the international classification of the WHO on disability, as well as the Quebec method. And every method has its pluses and drawbacks, which should be considered. To conclude, Senegal is committed to pursuing this topic and is reviewing several methods of assessing disability, as well as promoting national measures to address disability. Of course, financial and technical means are required, and Senegal requests the assistance of the United Nations in this regard through its mission in New York. I thank you.
Thank you very much for your comments. I next call upon the distinguished representative from Japan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We agree with the comments made by some of the panelists that in order to respond to the issue of poverty and disability, it is important to promote the employment of the persons with disabilities and share good practices in this field. So one of the examples of Japan's national efforts is that we urge companies to keep the legally mandated employment rate of persons with disabilities in the total regular employees 2.0%. To those companies that have not yet achieved this employment rate, ministries provide instructions to assist them to achieve this employment rate. In addition, based on Japan's Sustainable Development Goals implementation guiding principles, we help persons with disabilities find their jobs according to their preferences and personal characteristics. And we also provide vocational training to persons with disabilities. On the other hand, in implementing these measures, gender perspectives, such as advancing gender equality and mainstreaming a gender perspective, should be reflected in these measures. And in this regard, well-developed gender statistics are crucially important. We would like to hear comments by the panelists about what measures should be taken from the gender perspective to work on the issue of poverty and disability. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. I next call upon the distinguished representative from Zambia.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and members of the panel. Zambia is implementing inclusive, robust social protection programs, and with a spatial targeting in urban areas, mostly focused on persons with disabilities. The additional costs and that come with disability are also factored in this. Is there a social protection package that is aimed at weaning people off these social protection programs in order to reduce the dependency syndrome? Thank you.
Thank you. I next call upon the representative from the School Sisters of Notre Dame.
Thank you. I appreciate this opportunity to address the commission. As the vice chair of the NGO Committee on Social Development, I want to note with gratitude that more than one panelist reiterated the importance of the point that poverty increases the risk of disability, which increases the risk of poverty, which increases the risk of disability. And in light of the challenge of SDG number one to end poverty in all its forms everywhere, I think this point is worth being repeated. We are wondering, since several of the panelists mentioned social protection, what would be the next concrete steps that could be taken to provide social protection for people with disabilities? Or alternatively, should the goal be a universal social protection policy that is inclusive of all peoples, including peoples with disability, youth, the aging, and the marginalized? Thank you.
Thank you. I next call upon the distinguished representative from Botswana.
Thank you very much, moderator. And let me take this time to thank the chairperson and the distinguished presenters who gave us a very informative information in their deliberations. And just wanted to share a little bit of what Botswana has achieved in terms of inclusion of people with disabilities and ensuring that people with disabilities also engage in economic empowerment activities. Botswana government established the Disability Office in 2015 in the Office of the President, and I think it is very, very important for governments or states to ensure that they establish the Disability Office where there is power, where there is influence. And this office coordinates the implementation of the disability policy, and we have successfully established coordinating structures from all levels, from government as well as in all the districts. And this is also important in the sense that the National Coordinating Committee on Disabilities is made up of permanent secretaries who are accounting officers, and they decide or determine the mainstreaming strategy of people with disabilities and ensure that there is people-centered planning, which ensures that each and every department include people with disabilities. Like the moderator said, disability is a cross-cutting issue. And this has helped us a lot in the sense that most of departments at the moment, they're battling with ensuring that their policies, their programs are now disability friendly, and they are inclusive of people with disabilities. There is promotion in terms of access to information. Policies are being brailled, as well as buildings are made accessible. And it has also assisted us in the sense that all the laws, the legislations that have been discriminating against people with disabilities are being amended. And we are also sanctioned that even the policy, the 1996 policy on or for people with disabilities, is before Parliament at the moment. And though we have not rectified the CRPD, we are happy because the policy itself that is before the Parliament is in line and in the spirit of the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. When it comes to poverty and disabilities, we have also in the Office of the People with Disabilities, of which I am the coordinator as a person with disability as well, we have developed the guidance in which actually is guiding now the programs of poverty eradication program on ensuring that they include people with disabilities. And we are also working on the affirmative action guidelines, which we are ensuring that people with disabilities who have not been or which have been excluded are now included in the programs of poverty eradication. When it comes to employment of people with disabilities, we have made a deliberate program where all people with disabilities, whenever they finish their education, government is forced to employ them. And we are happy that it is working well. People with disabilities are now having access to employment. And I wanted to finish by asking or maybe posing a question to World Bank, because I know that when World Bank sneezes, all members of states shivers. And I want to ask Professor Johnson about what is it that they are really doing in ensuring that the states, more member states, are true to the implementation of all treaties that we have around people with disabilities. The other thing, we are scared that World Bank is encouraging other countries to reduce their wage bill. Is this not now going to make our efforts really not to achieve our goals, in the sense that governments may end up hiding behind the fact that the wage bill needs to be reduced and not now allow or give us an opportunity for people with disabilities to be employed? And the biggest challenge that we have also is the data, especially for people with disabilities. And to what extent can one get assistance from World Bank? Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I'm delighted that you're posing so many questions. We're going to take a few more queries from the floor. The Somali Help Age Association will speak next, but I'll also note that we'll take questions from Malawi, Kenya, and Rehabilitation International, and then we'll put the members of the panel on the spot to answer the questions raised. So let me turn the floor over to the Somali Help Age Association.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and distinguished and guests and delegates. It is a great honor for me to come and present in this high-level forum. And it's my first time to come this high-level gathering. And as we are representing in Somali Help Age Association, and what we have and been struggling and campaigning and in the national level And the issue of disability was something which is wider, and in terms of intervention and through to make sure no one is left behind. And as everybody of you might be aware, and Somalia has not been having a strong central government since 1990, and all civil and social infrastructure of the country were completely collapsed. And provided that there has been, you know, continuing insurgencies and extremism violences that led the country to and to fall behind. So as a civil society organization and as a Somali heritage organization, the issue of disability become and very much important in terms of the intervention. And for example, the country, which is almost, according to the United Nations, is for almost 15 million people, a quarter of them are disability people. And even you cannot imagine and those kind of people who are just immigrated from their country and become refugee elsewhere in the Dadaab refugee camp, and the population is so high. So, and what we have and aware is that the disability people in the even in the capital Mogadishu, the government offices, they have no accessible offices, and when the people disability try to reach the government is and even the building and the institution is building the people of disability, and they cannot afford to reach, and as other and panel and mentioned before, most of the people and living with disability rely on the begging. And they share the same for the rest of the countries. So, and in those uncertainties and the political conflicts, uncertainties of the tribal conflicts and in the country, and resulted a lot of people who are displaced and disabled to migrate and to the rest of the countries. And the policy framework and strategic development is addressing the needs of the people with disability were so much and prioritized, provided that the most of the humanitarian community and working in this kind of the disability projects and programs were very limited. And this is the why, and we were so much become very shocked and very worrying, and that the and some of the, you know, the humanitarian community were not focusing those kind of disability people in our country. Imagine a large number of people who are displaced, hungry, homeless, suffering of curable diseases and require immediate medical care, and rely on their life is on the streets, whereby they don't have any means of living. So, and in this and high level and commission of sustainable development, I would like to just and comment and suggest all those kind of policies and policy frameworks and strategies that addressing the people with disabilities, and any kind of intervention and protection issues and targeting the people with disabilities should be addressed for the such kind of countries that are zero and zero income people, who have the very strong and who don't have the very strong central government in place. And there is also to mention that the Al-Shabaab extremist group, which is the terrorist group operating in the country, they ban all the humanitarian communities and organizations to go and operate and the areas they control. And that's why the most of the, you know, the Somalis and also the disabled people to strand the rural communities and the rural remote rural communities, and whereby they